Worldwide, ASMR has been trending over both chocolate and food on YouTube searches since 2010, according to Google Trends data, and the interest is only increasing.
ASMR stands for Autonomous Sensory Meridian Response and is used worldwide to provide both physical and emotional benefits.
What's common to all these triggers for ASMR is they're all human generated. So it's a human voice. It's sounds created by humans. It's light touch from a human. It's the movement of humans. These gentle stimuli almost always occur during moments of positive personal attention. And these moments happen in real life, but they can also be simulated in videos, hence the origin of ASMR videos, where there's an individual in a video who's just simulating these moments of positive personal attention with these gentle sounds and this gentle voice.
Sleepyhead. ASMR feels like a pleasant little brain massage. Whether you enjoy ASMR or not, your brain is having a pretty incredible sensory experience. So what are brain tingles?
Yeah, these tingles are the signature aspect of ASMR. They're described as being light, staticky, and sparkly, but enjoyable. They almost always start in the head, and they may spread then from the brain down the spine into other parts of the body. Some people can feel deeply relaxed and say, well, I really don't feel the tingles. Some people will feel slight tingles, and some people will almost be overwhelmed by the strength of the tingles.
You may enjoy the sound of a nice, satisfying popcorn crunch, but it's not my thing. Every person experiences ASMR differently. In fact, about 20% of the entire population experiences ASMR and loves it. And then there's 20% who hate it.
It's really curious that people can hear whispering or chewing or tapping or mouth sounds. And the people who are experiencing ASMR are super relaxed. But there's also about 20% of the population that will have the very polar response. And that's referred to as misophonia. Misophonia is a negative reaction to specific sounds. And curiously, these sounds tend to be the same sounds that stimulate ASMR and relaxation in some people. And it is unclear as to why do some people become so relaxed to these sounds and why do some people become so annoyed. There have been some studies that have compared brain scans of individuals who experience ASMR and also misophonia. And they do see that some of the brain regions have different connections compared to control brains.
There has been only one study that has done a random population sampling of ASMR contenders. 12,000 participants across 6 countries listened to ASMR video clips. About 24% of participants said they experienced deep relaxation, and about 14% experienced brain tingles.
I think we still have a lot to learn about the basic physiology. I think what's clearly established from a lot of peer-reviewed studies is that people find ASMR super relaxing and they get brain tingles. There's been 2 peer-reviewed studies that have shown a reduced heart rate. There's been at least 1 peer-reviewed study that has showed a reduction in blood pressure. No one's reported on respiratory rate. You would anticipate that if someone is relaxed while experiencing ASMR, that their rate of breathing would also slow down. You would expect their stress hormone levels to decrease. And the measurable one would be like cortisol. And oxytocin is a great candidate for probably being responsible for a lot of the effects of ASMR. The next big studies also that could be done are clinical studies, where you start off with patients who have confirmed diagnoses, and then you compare how they respond to ASMR triggers to evidence-based treatments. But those big studies haven't been done yet.
Do you remember that scene from Ratatouille when Remy eats the cheese and the fruit, and he sees shapes when he chews?
Yeah.
Well, that's very similar to a concept closely related to ASMR called synesthesia. ASMR is limited to the physical sensations one may feel, like brain tingles, static sensations, and deep relaxation within your body. So are the two related? And are they causal to one another?
Both of them involve individuals who react differently to stimuli than most other people. So for ASMR, the strange reaction can be this deep relaxation is brain tingles. For synesthesia, it is a wrong response to a certain stimulus. So imagine someone is tasting a food, but they see shapes, or something touches their skin and they taste something on their tongue. it's a wrong response. A lot of people do think that ASMR and synesthesia may be the same thing, but they don't manifest in the same way, so I'm not sure that that's gonna pan out long term. One study in 2015, which was actually the first peer-reviewed published study about ASMR, which did look at this question of, are people who experience ASMR more likely to experience synesthesia? And their conclusion was no. When they looked at it statistically, there was no statistical significance that they did. But then a 2022 peer-reviewed publication came out looking at the same question, and they showed that people who experience ASMR were more likely to experience synesthesia. But is it causal? Does having ASMR cause someone to have synesthesia, or vice versa? In that same paper that just came out, they looked at those who have the strongest response to ASMR. Those people were less likely to experience synesthesia. It may just be that these things can be associated because there's some underlying event which can make them both manifest.
I've had very fond memories from my childhood of my mom brushing my hair and braiding it. Today, I try to be gentle with brushing my own daughter's hair, and while I'm not sure she's feeling the tingles, I find the act of brushing hair to be really soothing. Life experiences are one cause for a strong ASMR response. Another strong trigger is the sound of writing, which could be related to childhood school experiences. But there's also an evolutionary component, where naturally human senses have evolved over time. So does that have anything to do with ASMR?
From the day we're born, we have an alert response. If there's a loud noise, if something moves quickly in front of us or comes at us, or someone grabs us roughly, we become alert. Why? Because we know we're in danger, or we perceive we're in danger. Some people have a heightened alert response. They have a stronger response when they hear a strange noise, whether as a child or as an adult. And if you've ever sat on a couch with someone and watched a scary movie, that other person might be the type of person who jumps out of their seat every time something sudden happens in the movie, and you may not be. So as we get older, we might show more so this difference that we have in a response that we had since birth. What we also have is the opposite. We have something that I refer to as the soothe response. We are hardwired to be able to soothe by certain signals, and they're just the opposite of the alert response. And if you watch any parent soothing a child, they're using all those basic pattern recognition that the infant will have. The soft voice, the light touch, the gentle movements, and we retain all those as we get older. So what is ASMR then? ASMR is just a heightened soothe response. So instead of being a little bit soothed and a little bit relaxed by someone's voice, some people are super relaxed. There is this clear evolutionary advantage to having a soothe response and having a heightened soothe response, because that allows you to be more soothed. So, and you can come up with lots of moments where being soothed can be beneficial to a situation and beneficial to the health of the individual.
There is much to learn about the health benefits of ASMR. It turns out that there are some really incredible medical benefits.
ASMR could have medical benefits for people with diagnosed conditions like anxiety, insomnia, and depression. And those are much more severe conditions. Like, I can say I'm stressed at a certain moment, but that's different from anxiety, which is a much stronger stress response. We have collected information from people who are diagnosed with these conditions, and we've asked them, how does ASMR help you? So for those individuals that confirm they were diagnosed with the condition of anxiety, about 80% of them said that ASMR helps them to reduce their stress, and about 50% of them said that ASMR helps them when they're having the moments that are anxiety. Similarly with insomnia, for those patients or individuals that are diagnosed with insomnia, about 80% say that they use ASMR to help themselves to fall asleep. When they have the real severe problems of insomnia, about 50% say that ASMR helps them to sleep. It doesn't seem to be as helpful for individuals with depression as it is for individuals with anxiety and insomnia. Those individuals who say they're diagnosed with depression, about 40% will say that ASMR videos will help lift their mood generally. Mm-hmm. And of those people diagnosed with depression, about 30% say that the ASMR is helpful when they have the bouts of depression. But those numbers are pretty incredible, that they're helping someone with these diagnosed conditions that may be treated with medicine or expensive therapies that could be helped by just watching a simple, free, always available ASMR video.
Is there a difference between real-life ASMR and an ASMR video? Well, basically, both can trigger strong responses, but they may manifest differently based on the individual.
There doesn't seem to be overall that it's better through a video or it's better through real life. Individually, people will tell you that they have a better response to one of those situations. The person may feel more relaxed, more comfortable, and more safe in one of those situations compared to the other one. The real life, they might just feel a real good connection to that friend who's playing with their hair. Or when they're watching a video, they don't have to feel like they're a burden to anyone. Instead, they can just hit play and not feel like they're being judged or putting pressure on the other person to kind of do ASMR for them.
If you use fans or the sound of your television to help you fall asleep, you may consider checking out ASMR videos for even better results.
That is one of the most common uses of ASMR, whether it's an ASMR video or it's an ASMR podcast, is that people are listening to it as they're falling asleep. And they're reporting that it's helping them to fall asleep. And they're reporting that it's helping them to get better quality sleep. Yeah. No one's done yet a long-term sleep study, which involves a sleep lab and clinicians to really do the actual direct measurements on the quality of that sleep. It is very likely that it is helping them fall asleep and it is improving their quality because they keep doing it. And when they say they don't use the ASMR video or the ASMR podcast, then it's not helping them and they're not getting the sleep that they need. You're now replacing the stressful thoughts with this other content. And so your brain gets distracted away from being stressed. ASMR probably does something additional that the other types of sound sources don't do, and that is to provide this soothing feeling. So when you listen to the soft, gentle voice of an ASMR video, it's probably activating and releasing things like oxytocin, which are known to stimulate a relaxing response. And so it may be that ASMR does provide an additional benefit compared to these other sound sources that are helping people to fall asleep.
We don't know why some people experience ASMR and others don't, and why some get more benefits than others, such as stress relief. Researchers have no shortage of questions about how ASMR works. So what will we discover next?